It is our privilege to host Madame Christine Lagarde, the Managing Director of the International Monetary Fund here today at Georgetown University in Qatar. My name is Gerd Nonneman. I'm the Dean of Georgetown University in Qatar here. It's my privilege. I want to extend, obviously, a very warm welcome to Madame Lagarde and her delegation from the IMF, and a special welcome and thanks to our co-sponsor of this event, the Ministry of Finance, and particularly Mr. Badr Al-Qayed, the Director of International Cooperation, and his colleagues. It was a priority of Madame Lagarde to meet with the youth of Qatar, and I'm delighted to see that there are so many young people here. I was tempted for a minute to include myself, but I won't. Including, of course, as I said, our own Georgetown students, but including many from Qatar University, other education city universities, and I recognize some faces, the College of the North Atlantic in Qatar, the American School of Doha, and several other institutions, including also the Doha Institute, I gather. We're grateful to the Ministry of Finance for selecting Georgetown as their partner for this event. We'd like to think we're sort of a natural choice, not only because our focus is on global affairs in the broadest sense, but also because one of our claims to fame is our program in international economics. I'd like to make special mention in that context of one of our very own alumni, Ahmed Hilal. Yes, I see him right here in the front row, a 2009 graduate from our very first cohort in Qatar, who is now an international specialist with the Ministry of Finance. And I want to thank Ahmed for playing a key role in bringing our two organizations together for this event. Christine Lagarde was born in Paris and took her pre-university education in France, but rounded it off with a year in the United States, where she also worked as an intern on Capitol Hill. She then took a law degree at the Université Paris 10, or those who know Paris West Nanterre La Défense, following this with a master's degree in political science from Sciences Po Aix, or the Institut d'études politiques in Aix-en-Provence. And I believe has for the past 5 years also been chair of the board of governors or board of directors of Sciences Po Aix, or you were indeed. So that's another link with our academic world here. After being admitted to the Paris bar as a lawyer, she joined the international law firm of Baker & McKenzie, specializing in labor, antitrust, and mergers and acquisitions. And she joined the executive committee of that firm in 1995. She became chairman of the global executive committee of Baker & McKenzie in 1999, and subsequently chairman of the global strategic committee in 2004. A year later, Madame Lagarde joined the French government as Minister for Foreign Trade. After a brief stint as Minister of Agriculture and Fisheries, in 2007, she became the first woman to hold the post of Minister of Finance and Economy in any G8 country. From July to December 2008, she also chaired the ECOFIN Council, which brings together the ministers of finance and economy of the European Union. And as a member of the G20, Christine Lagarde was involved in that group's management of the global financial crisis, helping to foster international policies related to financial supervision and regulation, and to strengthen global economic governance. As chairman of the G20 in 2011, when France held the G20 presidency, she launched a wide-ranging work agenda on the reform of the international monetary system. So when that year, the IMF's managing director position became vacant, it should come as no surprise that she was just about everyone's favorite candidate, having built up an enviable reputation as a supremely capable economic leader and diplomat. So in July 2011, Christine Lagarde became the 11th managing director of the IMF and the first woman to hold that position. Her achievements and contribution were recognized in France the following year by the award of the rank of officier in the Légion d'honneur. Some of this may be familiar to many of you. What may be less so is that she was also an accomplished sportswoman. She's a former member of the French national team in synchronized swimming. Last but not least, she is the mother of two sons. Madame Lagarde will speak for about 15 minutes and will then have a conversation with the audience based on your questions. Now, you've probably already seen the instructions about an electronic student poll that we will hold, where we're asking those of you who are students, that's to say at schools or universities or colleges, two questions. One about what are your main concerns at this point in time, and one on your plans after you graduate. Later on, I will show you the results of that poll. I'll come back to it after Madame Lagarde's remarks. And the results of the poll will feed into the discussion afterwards. So again, this, just to note that that poll, for which you will get some further guidance later, is just for those at school, college, or university. So I would now like to invite Madame Lagarde to the lectern to open today's conversation.
Well, thank you very much, Dean. Merci beaucoup. Is there anybody from France in the room? Hello. I have, two compatriots. Well, bonjour. Massa halker, massa cum halla belker. All right, there are more than two that understood vaguely what I mispronounced, and I apologize, please, for this mispronunciation. Dean, I would like to thank you for your very kind and very comprehensive introduction. You spared no details, including on timing. You know, past a certain age, you have to be a bit light on years, but you were very keen and very accurate in your description. So I thank you very much for that. And this is really a blessing to hear a teeny tiny bit of that Belgian accent that I love so much. My grandfather was actually Flemish. So I could just sense that. Thank you very much to the Ministry of Finance, and thank you very much to all three of you, because I understand that as an alumni, you are a member of the Ministry of Finance as an intern or as a very young, recently graduated, talented man. So thank you very much for sponsoring this event as well and for selecting this wonderful place. Thank you to all of you from all corners of the world, from the various schools that you belong to, the various colleges that you belong to as well, for sparing what is, I understand, a very limited time with us, because I understand that because of the timeline we are on, at 1:30 on the dot, everybody will disappear. So I'm going to try to use the next 10 minutes to just say a few things about matters that we care about. Let's see if that works. And yes, it does, actually. I can walk around. That's brilliant. What I would like to do is maybe give you a few bits of information, and I'm not going to go into a long lecture because I would need a lot more time, as to how we see the world and what the global outlook is from our perspective at the IMF, and then maybe also share with you what we see in terms of the Gulf countries and what, from this local perspective, this regional perspective, can be actually improved upon in the coming weeks, months, and prepare for a better future. But before that, I would like to simply say that from a personal point of view, from an IMF point of view, from the point of view of those that try to support development, although this is not the main purpose and the exclusive mission of the IMF, but it is part of our membership, we believe that the best investments that you can make, that your parents can make, that your sponsors can make, is actually to invest in education. So what you are doing at the moment is really the best that can be done to prepare for the future. And if you were to ask me where I would invest money in the education of girls. And that is definitely, as far as low-income countries or developing countries are concerned, as well as any other countries, the best return for your money that you can benefit from. And this country, its leaders And whoever is actually supporting those initiatives is doing an awful lot and has contributed an awful lot to education, to culture, and this is really the smart way to go about development of human beings, development of economies, development of countries. So, the world economic outlook as we see it from our perspective is what I would describe as a bit fragile, quite uneven, and in complete transition. And let me start by those transitions. The reason I say fragile is because we are simply seeing a growth that is not conducive to responding to the needs of the population. We have at the moment about 200 million people looking for jobs. There's 60 million refugees or displaced people around the world, and we have a growth that is going to be probably about 3.1% this year, a little bit more next year, and that compares with 3.4% last year, which everybody considered as not exactly satisfactory. So it's not enough to actually respond to the needs of people around the world. That's what makes me say that it is fragile. Why do we say that it is uneven? Because there are areas of the world that are leading the charge. We're leading the charge no longer, and I'm talking here about the emerging market economies, and others that have been lagging behind and that are recovering a little bit, and those are the advanced economies. So we are seeing at the moment a slight shift from a pattern that we were becoming accustomed to, where emerging market economies were driving growth and were producing about 80% of global growth, to a stage where, because of different circumstances, which are very country-specific, they are slowing down, sometimes contracting, as is the case for Brazil and Russia, for instance, sometimes expanding, but you know, in a fairly isolated way in that group of emerging market economies like India. Slowing down as well in the developing countries, in sub-Saharan Africa, which together with developing Southeast Asia was the driving force behind most of growth. All of that is slowing down quite a bit, and I'll come to why we think it is slowing down, and I'll explain one of the transitions that we see at the moment. At the same time, we have advanced economies that have suffered heavily from the financial crisis of 2008 and sequitur, which are doing a little bit better, certainly led by the United States, which we foresee at around 2.8% and maybe a bit more next year, and the UK, which is also thriving relative to other European areas, countries. So advanced economies doing a bit better. Even the euro area, which a lot of us, including nationals from my own countries, have been complaining about and felt bad about, even the euro area is also heading in a positive direction and certainly around 1.7%, 1.8%. Shift. Growth will be less contributed to by the emerging and developing countries, a bit more so by the advanced economies, but altogether we regard it as too fragile a growth to actually respond to the needs of the people around the world. Transitions. All right, question to you. Can somebody name one country where there is massive transition at the moment? South Africa, yes. But I'm thinking about one that contributes a bit more to the overall. Yes, somebody said China. I don't, oh, well done. Okay. I think you're right. And I think we're seeing at the moment, and that's the, you know, it's the beginning of a process that we believe is going to last quite a while. We're seeing a combined transition, both in terms of monetary policy, which we are seeing in development at the moment, but also in terms of business model, if I may say. Some of you are studying business, I'm sure, because you are studying all sorts of things in these universities. Change in the monetary policy of, I hope you don't mind if I walk around, but I'm always on planes, sitting. So I'm very happy to walk around here and to get a bit closer to some of you. So the monetary policy of China is clearly changing as we speak. And from being very much a control, command, highly intervened type of policy, where the currency was monitored very closely on a daily basis, we're heading towards a mechanism where clearly the Chinese authorities want to go towards a more floating currency mechanism with monetary policy that will be appropriately modified as a result of that. Transition number one. And that is going to have a significant impact. Together with that, the Chinese authorities are very pleased to consider that their currency could become a reserve currency and might even eventually be included in the special drawing rights. Okay, question for you. Who knows that what the special drawing rights are? Hey, not bad, two or three of you. Okay, the special drawing rights is a very interesting mechanism which was invented back in 1969 within the IMF in order to put together a few reserve currencies to set up this new currency that would be a mechanism by which central banks could actually transfer, convert monies amongst themselves, and that could eventually be used as a hedge between some of those central banks within the international banking system. It's called the special drawing rights, and currently it has the dollar, the euro, the sterling, and the yen. And what is happening at the moment is that China, with its renminbi, is trying to have the Chinese currency included in that special drawing right, which is regarded for their purposes as probably a recognition of the reserve status that the renminbi could have and an acceleration of transactions that are actually in Chinese currencies. So transition number one, I hope I'm not going to be too long, but I fear that I can get carried away with this. Transition number two is the business model. From being heavily driven by export, from being heavily invested in large projects and having their growth driven by investment, clearly there is a move in the direction of being more domestically focused, to have their growth more driven by consumption, and that is going to significantly affect a country that is moving from a strong manufacturing base to a strong service base. That's the kind of transition that we are seeing. Now, it has an impact on another transition, which we are seeing and which you are seeing very clearly in this part of the world, which is the reduction of prices of commodities in general and clearly the reduction of the price of oil. Lower demand coming out of some of the emerging market economies, including in particular China, has an impact on oil, but also metals, but also food, and pretty much across the board at the moment, commodity prices are down, some of them significantly down. And for those countries whose business model was driven by, for instance, the production, supply, and export of copper or iron ore, or eventually oil and gas, it has a significant impact. The third transition that we are, and I'll come back to that in a second to close my comments before I just give the floor to you. The third transition that we're seeing at the moment is also something that has been much talked about, where there has been a lot of trepidations and concerns and wonders about the timing, is the monetary policy of some of the central banks of the advanced economies. And there is a lot of talk as to when. When what? Yes, when will the interest rate determined by the Fed and the board of the Fed will actually be decided? Is it going to be September? No, gone. Is it going to be October? No. Will it be December? Maybe. Could it be the first quarter? So those are the questions that many emerging market economies, particularly their central authorities, whether the Ministry of Finance, Treasury, or in the central banks, are wondering. And that change will actually indicate that for the first time in the last 9 years, the Fed, US largest monetary authority in the world at the moment, the Fed will actually determine that, number one, unemployment has gone down and employment and participation rates have improved significantly, and that, number two, inflation might be heading in the direction of what is regarded as the appropriate target by the authorities, which is 2%. So that's good. Because if unemployment goes down, participation rates in the job market goes up, and inflation is slightly a bit more than the low level where it was, it means that the economic situation of that country is improving. And given that it is, at least on a market basis, the largest economy in the world, not exactly the same in PPP numbers, it's a good signal for everybody. Yes, but as a result of that change of interest rates, which would be very gradual, very small in the first place, but probably followed by others down the road, capital movements will occur. And the outflow that we saw in the last few years towards high yields products, towards high yields markets, is probably going to decline, if not reverse. We are also going to see appreciation of the currency. And particularly for countries that are pegged to the dollar, it's going to mean an appreciation of their respective currency, but also a good tool against potential inflation. So for all of these transitions, which are going to affect the respective economies within which they are decided, there will be what we call the spillover effects. So when the Fed decides something, it has an impact in the flow of capital that goes to South Africa, for instance, or to Brazil. When the Chinese model changes and the growth rate is down to about 6.5%, as opposed to the high digit numbers that we saw and sometimes the double digit numbers that we saw a few years back, it has an impact on the rest of the world. And when low commodity prices move down, well, it has an impact on the business model. And that is the point that I will finish with, and then I'll come back and join you for that conversation. In oil-producing countries, and in the GCC notably, there has been clearly a concern, and I think that we have discussed that extensively in the last few days, but in Qatar, it has been a matter under review and under scrutiny for more than a few weeks, and legitimately so, in order to see how that external shock, which is a matter of the supply and demand operations in that particular market, how that shock is going to affect the economy, and what measures need to be taken, what policy measures need to be adopted in order to resist to that shock. And I have to say that as far as this country is concerned, there has clearly been a set of good measures, good policies envisaged in order to diversify the economy, in order to resist the significantly lower revenues, both for fiscal purposes as well as for export purposes, in order to actually continue to support the economy and make sure that growth continues. When you look at the Qatar numbers, for instance, and you look at the non-oil activity, growth is extremely impressive. You're in the range of 10% growth on non-oil products. Now, of course, if you include oil, because of what we have seen in terms of prices, there is a lower number in the, we see it at about 4%, 4-ish percent next year, which is pretty good relative to many other countries as a number. So what I'm trying to say here is that because of these transitions and because of these external factors and because of the situation in which an economy is and the leadership that policymakers can actually display, what could be regarded as a negative situation can actually be transformed in such a way that the economy continues to work properly. And those who will be the players, the actors of the economy, can also have a change of mind. And I'll finish with that one. How many of you in the room, and maybe that's one of the questions that will be asked, so maybe I should be quiet on that. But what I would suggest is that in a space and times when the source of revenue which was comfortable and guaranteed is being reduced, whether it's the revenue of oil, whether it's the revenue of copper, whether it's the revenue of any kind of key activity, well, other activities have to be considered. And your individual business model might be considered, and your aspirations might be different. So instead of assuming that everything is taken for granted and there is an entitlement to this, that, or the other, well, private sector jobs might be interesting. Setting up your own company might be interesting. Demonstrating entrepreneurship in the future and creating value by yourself might be very interesting and actually could be beneficial for you and for the country as well. So it's with that opening of the mind, given the market circumstances changes and the geopolitical changes as well, which I will not touch upon because the IMF does not look at geopolitical issues except for its impact on the economy. It's in that context that I very much hope that you all actually consider multiple options, not necessarily join the public sector, not necessarily do what your parents have done in the past, but possibly look at completely different things and be prepared to take some risks in an environment that can actually reward you for the risk that you're taking, and hopefully an environment where, even if you fail having taken risks, you can bounce back and try again. Thank you very much, and I'll be extremely happy to actually hear your views, understand your comments, and respond to any questions that you have on this and any other matters that are relevant to the IMF and to me. Thank you.
Thank you very much. This sets up a number of things already, and we have time. Now, in the meantime, I think the screen is coming down. If those of you who are students at schools, universities, colleges here who are not yet in the world of work could go to our website, and you'll see it in a minute there, or you might already have seen it outside. It's qatar.sfs, on your mobiles, presumably, qatar.sfs.georgetown.edu, you have it up there now, /IMF. First of all, I think your final comment, His Highness the Emir, would have been delighted to hear that, and he'd be even more delighted if lots of the young people here actually take you up on it, because that very much seems to be the message of the day, and it also seems to be part of an emerging pattern across the Gulf states, and it goes alongside things such as reducing subsidies in a number of areas and so on. Having said that, how sanguine are you and the IMF when you look at these economies that more than tinkering is likely to happen, and that the societal carrying capacity for the changes that you might think are necessary is sufficient to change it to societies or economies where the private sector genuinely is adding value, where the non-oil sector is genuinely non-oil as opposed to still funded by oil or gas. The size of the shift, you know, how big is it? How sanguine are you that it's going to get anywhere near the necessary shift? Looking particularly, for instance, at Saudi Arabia at the moment, but not just Saudi Arabia.
Well, you know, I don't want to ring a huge big alarm bell, because there's one point that many of these countries have in common, which is that they have, over the last decade or so, built a strong buffers, if you will. So they have, whether they've done it through some external funds, in their own reserves, in their various compartments, they have accumulated significant buffers, which dwarf many other reserves around the world. So that's number one. With those buffers, they start from a position of strength. But if they were only to rely on their reserves, or if they were to move in the direction of massive borrowing, that would not be sufficient, and it would not protect them and cover them for the many decades to come. And those buffers would be extinguished, and lenders will only lend on the basis of a good business case, a promising reimbursement of their debt, and will value the risk and determine the interest rates at which they lend on that basis. So I would say that the current situation is an excellent wake-up call, actually, for many of the countries that have relied extensively on, you know, the single blessing of nature, if you will, to restructure, to find alternative sources of revenue, to identify in all the spendings what is necessary, what can be most and more efficiently managed in the future, and, which is the third pillar of that revision of the business model, how private sector can be better integrated and more welcome in those countries where the effort has not yet been undertaken. So I would say that strong base from which to start, mm-hmm. therefore no need to go abruptly and suddenly, but that period of time when countries can actually afford to use some of their buffers is also a time when they have to phase in new concepts. Mm-hmm. One example, you know, to assume that anything is totally free, for instance, needs to be revisited and re-examined. To assume that you can consume without limitation fossil oil, for instance, water. I mean, all resources that we know are scarce and limited with a time frame, but are limited ultimately. I think those concepts and those basic principles that many countries have operated upon need to be re-examined and new measures have to be taken. Mm-hmm. There is a lot of public money that is spent on subsidizing the use of fossil energy without any variation as to whether you have a significant wealth and significant income or whether you are in need mm-hmm. of that support. Well, that needs to be re-examined across the world, across the board as well, not just in those countries, but in many countries that actually practice these policies.
Thank you. In fact, I was saying that there is something of an emerging trend of beginning these things being discussed, and I was struck this morning, in fact, that there was a report about the Minister of Planning who was yesterday in Qatar was referring, and it's the first time I'd heard it, referring to the need to rethink energy subsidies in Qatar even. So, well, at this point, I think you've seen behind you, and I'll have to turn around to see it myself, the results of our poll. So, what issue concerns you the most?
Wow.
On the right, you see that the types of things, opportunities for women expatriates, 24%, GCC financial environment and low oil prices, 15%. GCC stability and security, 30 or 14%, environment for 15%, finding a job, alignment of your education with the job market, over 30%. What do you plan to do after graduation? And nobody had any idea about these outcomes. They've literally just been produced by yourselves. More than half of you say go to college or graduate school, so that indicates to me, that's very hopeful. I'd be interested to see your reaction to that. 22% say they aim to work in the private sector. This must be a special audience. Work in the public sector, about 15%. And then we have 9% to start your own business. And finally, working in a company owned by the government, well, a minor percent, perhaps 5% or 4%. So I wonder, Madame Lagarde, if you have any initial responses to or reactions to those results.
Well, you know, the piece that you are immediately tempted to comment upon or to try to draw some understanding and learning from is this 52% go to college/graduate school. And it goes to the first point that I was trying to make in the first place when opening the discussion, which is that education, improving the skills, is the best investment that you can make, and I think it's that's the answer. Now, I personally think that education, improving your skills, learning is not going to be limited to a period of your life. You know, for whatever it is, mm-hmm. 4 years or 8 years or maybe 10 years for those who go into PhD and drafting dissertations, as the Germans would call it. But it's an ongoing process where, thanks to the audacity of schools like yours, or to the availability of online training, we will continue to learn constantly. I would take this opportunity, actually, to mention that for those of you who are interested in macroeconomics, and I understand that you are providing a lot of macroeconomic teaching at Georgetown University, the IMF now provides online training and education in the area of public finance management, in the area of debt sustainability analysis, and in the area of subsidy removal in a way that is completely free, completely available to any who cares to participate, and who can provide you with actual sort of, not graduation, because we do not we do not actually call it graduation, but full qualification under the cycles of training that we offer. So that's my first comment. I think it's just great that you know, more than half of you are actually interested in continuing and acquiring more knowledge, more and develop your talent and your capacity. I think the one that is extremely comforting is, I'm still back in this one. It's the 4.4% working in the private sector. That goes totally, you know, against the sort of conventional wisdom that I was given, mm-hmm. where the aspiration, the natural aspiration of many would be to join the public sector or to join a state-owned entities and have an occupation as a member of the public sector. So I think it's great. I have myself transitioned from the private sector, where I spent the first more than 20 years of my professional life, to being drafted by the public sector as Minister of Finance, Minister of Trade first and Minister of Finance later afterwards. It's fascinating. I think you can sort of enrich yourself and acquire knowledge, understanding of the world, meet people, operate in a different fashion in both environments. And actually moving from one to the other is fascinating, because you can certainly adapt some of the skills or some of the methodologies that you had in one into the other and vice versa. So I think it's, I would certainly for my part encourage this idea that in addition to learning your life long, you are not necessarily into a particular professional corridor from which you will exit after so many years of service and then collect your pension. I think life is also in the future going to be about periods of time when you have a public job, periods when you have a private sector jobs, period when you're going to actually change your skill sets, because you cannot be forever the same person if you are learning all your life along, and if technologies actually break through in disrupting the environment in which we've been used to operate. I don't know, what do you think?
Yeah, no, very similar actually. I mean, I was struck by those 21.4% and by the 52%. And not surprising that the 32% at the top there, that's to be expected. That's going to be at the top, at the front of anyone's mind at this stage in life.
Opportunities for women and expatriate, 24%, and I'm sure that there are not just women and expats who have pressed that button, and I hope that many men actually have pressed the button to support that women be given plenty of opportunities. Mm-hmm. No smile in the room.
Oh, I can see a few. Okay, so at this point, let's open it up.
I'm Peter from the Doha Institute for Graduate Studies. And I have a very short question. Iran is opening soon as a great economic force and as a big market here in the region. How will this influence the regional economics and perhaps the world economics as well? And how the Gulf countries should approach Iran when it's opening up soon?
Sorry, what is opening up?
Iran.
Yeah.
Yeah, after the fall of the sanctions.
Okay.
Hello, it's Tom Finn from Reuters. You just come from Saudi Arabia, Madame Lagarde. Did you get firm statements of intention from the Saudis, especially in areas such as VAT, cutting fuel subsidies and curbing public wage bills? And we're also hearing this morning that Saudi Arabia might start issuing foreign bonds as soon as next year. Will the IMF help with this, and is it a good idea?
And so let's take one more for this at this point.
Hi, Diana from Georgetown. How closely do you think the global security situation and lower oil prices are interlinked? And what can local GCC economies do beyond fiscal adjustments to protect their standings? For example, do you think investment funds should, is it a good time for investment funds to accelerate asset purchases in Western markets?
Thank you. So if you, the others are patient for just a little while, and then perhaps we can come back.
Okay, I'll try to respond briefly, and I think it's great that students can ask the question. I understand that writers of this world want to also put their point in and take any opportunity to do so. I might disappoint you, actually. So will markets and this area of the world be influenced by the opening of Iran? Yes, clearly. Whether it's by virtue of... And I think I should qualify that by saying when sanctions are lifted and on the basis of the implementation of the agreement that has been found between Iran and the 5+1, when that happens, clearly there will be consequences as a result. I think you can start with the supply side and consider that, you know, with additional barrels of oil on the market as a result of the current capacity of the Iranian market, there will be an impact. The second is certainly to look at the demand side, and it's clearly a market which will be which will have an appetite for import of products that have not been available so far, whether, you know, the whole range of products and services that were not accessible to that country will be in demand. So yes, on both sides of this equilibrium, there will be an impact, and I'm only here talking about the economic consequences of it all. The relationship between security and oil is really something that I find a little bit hard to comment upon, because I'm not sure that at the IMF we have actually done in-depth study of the intimate relationship between the two, because our focus is not on security, our focus is on stability and economic and financial stability, and I can certainly comment on that. It's always been the case in the recent history that the variation of the price or the variation of available volumes of oil have had an impact on financial stability and economic stability in general. Now, that impact then entails a new equilibrium that is reset as a result of the variation in prices and volumes. And that's the fascinating thing about the economy, is that it constantly adapts and resets under different parameters. But it has always had an impact. You could argue that because of alternative sources of energy that will hopefully be also made available and focused upon as a result of the higher concern about the environment, climate change issues, and so on and so forth, that impact might be tempered. But I think to assume that as a result of the surge rise of renewable energy, the impact of oil will be very limited would not be, I think, the right conclusion. Now, what I have said at the Gulf Council meetings that was organized 2 days ago, and I have delivered the same message during my trip yesterday to Saudi Arabia, is that in the face of this new situation, triggered by the price of oil, which we see as not a short-term phenomenon, but a longer-term phenomenon, without setting an actual timeline, a bit like for the interest rates, as to when it will completely change course. In the face of that, measures have to be taken. And those measures include the whole range of what I have mentioned earlier. First of all, revisit the business model, revisit the conventional wisdom that people, business, and policy authorities have in order to take into account the new reality, that wake-up call that I referred to earlier, and then use all the tools available. And those tools are going to differ depending on the situation of the economy, its population, the terms under which people operate in that economy, and whether they will focus more importantly on what alternative revenues need to be raised on the basis of what taxation, for instance, or what spendings need to be revisited, reduced, or more efficiently managed. Or combined with that, because you need to make a compelling business model that you're looking at both sides of the balance sheets, combined with that, where do you invest and how do you select those new investments that you're considering? Because you have to think about growth, indeed. And how do you welcome the private sector? How do you make the environment more business-friendly going forward so that the private sector feels welcome, encouraged, and actually takes the baton from the public sector? So it's the whole series of measures that need to be considered going forward, added to which, for those that are facing a deficit, which is based on the IMF calculation at least, not the case in Qatar, the Qatari authorities calculate very slightly differently the deficit and do not take into account the estimated return from the significant investment programs that they have. So they actually identify a very small deficit, but a very small one. But for those countries in the area which have a significant deficit, they are going to have to consider what appropriate mix they want to put in place in order to finance such deficit, whether they want to draw on reserve, whether they want to draw on the domestic banking sector, whether they want to issue domestic bonds that would be more open to retail, whether they want to move internationally in bond issuance. That is going to be for them to actually set the most appropriate mix of products. Now, to address the new concern, the IMF is not in the business of packaging international bonds and doing that kind of job. We are, in a way, a general interest institution working for the world, for the 188 members of the institutions, and we certainly do not advise on the packaging of a bond. Now, we might opine on the most appropriate mix, whether you combine, you know, drawing on the domestic banking sector and risking possibly crowding private investment, whether you borrow on the international bond market, whether you draw a bit on reserves. That we can certainly have a view, but packaging of bonds, no, we don't do that.
Okay, so over on that, does that end?
I think you have a little microphone somewhere, not far.
Hello? Oh, there it is. Hello, my name is Ignacio. I'm a senior at the American School of Doha right now, but I'm also a student of economics learning about trade. You've talked a lot about the oil market and how that's causing changes within the regions that depend on them. But my question relates more to the interactions between those countries and countries such as my home country, the United States. The question is, given that the current trend in the oil prices is expected to be longer term, what role do you believe, or does the IMF believe, economic powers in other regions, such as the US, the UK, or the EU, should play in their interactions with the region? And do you believe that the current situation is on the right track, or should it be changed?
My name is Imad, a student at Georgetown University. And I just wanted to touch on your point of new emerging markets. So Brazil is the world's second largest producer of biofuels, and more specifically, ethanol fuel. And until 2010, it was the world's largest exporter. Together, Brazil and the United States led the industrial production of ethanol fuel, accounting for 88% of the world's production in 2010 and 87% in 2011, and produced 24.9% of the world's total biofuels as fuel. And it's also considered to be the first sustainable biofuels economy and a leader in the biofuel industry and a policy model for other countries.
Are you from Brazil?
No. Huh. It's just because I found it interesting that its economy is also contracting at the same time.
Yes, very much so.
With its new emerging market. So in your opinion, could its contracting economy be owed to the reason that many countries haven't conceived the implications of Brazil's pioneering model of a new emerging market?
Okay.
One more.
Hi. My name is Hisan, student in Georgetown, and I'm recently studying the Asian crisis, and I have a question about it. So IMF was blamed for several mistakes while it dealt with crisis in Asia, such as Thailand, Indonesia, and Korea. And what do you personally consider the most important mistake that it made? And I want to listen. I want to know, why do you consider it?
Which country are you from?
South Korea.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
All right. On the role of the U.S. in the oil market and whether changes of policies are would be appropriate, you know, I very much believe that in this energy market, a lot is actually determined by supply and demand, by cost threshold or you know, operational and profitability thresholds. And clearly, the development of some technologies that have reduced the cost of extracting notably gas, but also oil, in the United States, but other countries as well, have led to a significant price reduction that we have seen in the last 18 months or so. And, you know, it's not very, very mysterious. The more supply you have, and at constant demand, the adjustment is the result of price adjustment, which is what we have seen. So the real question is, you know, at what level is the new equilibrium going to settle? And at which, you have to also factor in, of course, the capital expenditure costs, which are very heavy in the traditional refinery and extraction world, which is not as heavy necessarily in other alternative sources of extractions. So it's a combination of all those factors that actually determine what is happening and who is supplying what to whom in the global economy at the moment. So I'm not sure that actually policies that would be decided by US authorities or by other authorities are going to have a major impact on the situation that develops as it does. What can have an impact is decisions to actually operate as a referee on those markets, but I don't think that it's a decision that would actually belong to the United States on this matter. I'm afraid to say that I'm not the ultimate expert on biofuels and on ethanol fuels, nor on the actual consequences of that as a definition of the Brazilian business model. And for the limited reading that I've done, I'm not either sure that the ethanol fuel is neither the best ultimate response to the alternative energies search that the world is at the moment in order to address the climate change issue, which is a pressing and very important one. The use of water, the capture of bioproducts as a result of this focus on the production of ethanol is also something that needs to be factored in when you determine which one is the best, which alternative source is the best one. What I would say on Brazil is that, you know, it is facing a combination of macroeconomic, monetary, and general governance shocks that are affecting the country and that are putting it at the moment in negative territory. I think our forecast is -3% and a little less, but still minus in 2017. So it's by addressing the macroeconomic situation, by adopting the right monetary policy, that the country can actually redress over time its current economic situation. I don't think it's a factor of any particular attitude or policy vis-a-vis the biofuel model that it is pursuing. On Asia, look, we all make mistakes, okay? And the IMF is no exception. We're trying to make as few mistakes as we can, but we do make mistakes. What we do, contrary to many others, is that we always try to recognize, acknowledge, go public, and review how we can avoid making mistakes of the nature that we have in order to improve going forward. And in that respect, you know, I'm very proud to lead an institution that sometimes gets a bashing for having got something wrong, but which goes public in saying, we did that wrongly. We did not take that particular factor into account. We assumed that the fiscal consolidation taken in a very, very harsh and rapid measure would actually turn the situation around in a different way. So we have done that 20 years ago when we made those mistakes. And when we do mistakes along the road, we will continue, and certainly, and you know, on my watch, we will continue to say so, because I think it's best to acknowledge, take the blame, if that is the case, but do better next time around. And, you know, complaints and complaints abound, memories last, but I have seen many instances, including in Asia, I have to say, of governments saying, yes, it was hard, and we went through the program and the restructuring in a difficult way, but thank goodness, you know, we did it because we are now in a much better off position and we are much stronger as a result. So, you know, we never intervene with programs. That's how, you know, the sort of lending in consideration for restructuring and conditionalities take place. We never intervene in programs when the situation is easy, rosy, and policymakers could have made the decision by themselves. We typically intervene in that program business line of ours when the situation is very serious, when the policymakers have not been able to turn the economy around, and when financing is no longer available. So, you know, it's a bit like Voltaire and Rousseau, for those of you who know these wonderful authors. And, you know, Rousseau saying to Voltaire, life is tough. And Voltaire saying, compared with what?
Hello, my name is Abdallah Zaidan. I'm a freshman at Georgetown University. And I was wondering, we all saw how you reacted to the 2008 crisis. You were one of the first to see the wave of the effect or the tsunami that the CDOs had and other corrupted financial products that the banks sold. Of course, you advised Hank Paulson, and you were very stringent with the advice you gave. But now I want to ask you, with the low interest rates and the increased quantitative easing, QE, that's going on in the US and the EU, where do you see this bubble heading? Because we are in a bubble. So where do you see it heading, and what, I mean, the effects, the after effects, which are probably going to be deflation, how do you see them manifesting themselves in asset classes? And that's my question. Thank you very much.
And finally.
Yeah, Shaman Naimi from Georgetown University. My question is, some contend that the IMF committed a clear tactical failure or error in Greece when choosing to take the unprecedented route of operating as part of a troika with the European Commission and the European Central Bank, by ruling out debt restructuring, which would have potentially given Greece a fresh new start, and instead allowing European politicians to dictate the initial terms of the Greek rescue. Do you believe that the IMF may have capitulated to political pressure at the people's expense? Mm-hmm.
Thank you. That's a very biased question. Okay, well, thank you for putting the hard question and being my last discussant, if I may. You know, I'm in a fairly comfortable position to answer your question. Are you taping me when I answer? Okay. I'll tell you why. When the first Greek program was put in place, I was Minister of Finance for my own country. So I saw things from a particular perspective. And the second program, I was then managing director of the IMF, so that was a different story as well. I think that the decision that was made at the time to avoid the restructuring of the Greek debt in the first program was certainly the right decision at the time. Why do I say that? Because it is contrary to the normal determination that we would have made in other circumstances. It is not because the IMF conceded to political authorities, but it is because Greece being part of a monetary union, that monetary union not being a fiscal union, not being a banking union, not having a firewall, not having what they have today, which is the European Stability Mechanism, which is endowed with 500 billion euros when they want to draw those amounts, did present the risk of potential systemicity of the crisis to the entire euro area, which is one of the largest economic regions in the entire economy. So at that point in time, clearly those who decided collectively, and I take my share of that as finance minister for my own country, assessed that risk to be too high in the trade-off between going for the private sector debt restructuring right away or trying to sustain that economy on a combined basis with other financial providers, given the size of the package that was needed to that effect. Now, very shortly after that, the discussions continued between the European players, particularly in the euro area, as to what could be put in place rapidly. And I remember the IMF was very engaged and active in encouraging us to put in place that firewall, and we did at the time, which then helped us, IMF, in the second program to actually ask for a private sector debt restructuring. Because in the meantime, we had also asked, and I was at the time leading the institution, we asked that the firewall be higher and bigger and be more helpful to support the zone. So that's what actually happened. The trade-off between the systemic risk that could very well have materialized and the traditional approach that is taken by the IMF led to that decision-making process and led to that financial package. Second program, as I said, was completely differently built. Now, in terms of monetary policy, we believe that under the present circumstances of that low demand, of that low inflation, it is appropriate for the monetary policy authorities to try to actually facilitate the financing of the economy, to facilitate the obtaining of credit by the private sector. The formation of bubble is, in a way, a bit of a collateral of what is intended, which is the financing of the economy in order to support demand as much as possible, monetary-wise, fiscal-wise as well. But it is certainly a policy that has to be reversed when the economic situation improves, as hopefully that is and will be the case in the United States.
Thank you. And on this note, we will have to wrap it up because Madame Lagarde has got two media interviews waiting for her around the corner here. So we're going to have to whisk her off right away. But thank you very much. Thank you.